Welcome to the Reptile Living Room, featuring John Taylor of Herphouse Magazine and James Tintle with ColdBlooded Publishing. The Reptile Living Room is brought to you by Herphouse Magazine, the premier digital magazine for the reptile hobbyist, and by ColdBlooded Publishing, your exclusive reptile media publishing company. Now, here are John and James in the Reptile Living Room.
All right, welcome everybody to the Reptile Living Room. This is James Tintle, your host, and we have John Taylor, our other host over there. How you doing today, John?
Excellent, James. How are you, sir?
I'm actually doing fairly well, man.
There you are.
Been a quite busy week this week.
Just a little bit.
Absolutely. So much going on. I mean, it's that time of year, eggs still being laid, eggs hatching. It's just crazy.
Talk to us about what you got hatching over there, man. Some interesting tricolors came out this couple days ago.
Yeah, I had a tricolor hognose from Paraguay actually hatch out this week. They were pretty popular. I mean, a lot of people have seen it through Facebook. Also have Puebloan milk snakes hatching as of the moment. They actually split their eggs, and I'll try to get a cool little shot in here for everybody. Let's see if we got a shot there. Have them sitting here. There we go. There's a cool little shot of them hatching. And that's about it, man.
Awesome.
So, staying pretty busy, that's for sure.
Yeah, for sure. We just, we're here at the, Reptile Farmer Group. We just opened up for some specific advertisements for certain tribe members, so we're sending out some informational emails and what have you. Right now, the single article on sale right now is the Tree Serpents of Summer, the rough green snakes.
Cool.
Heather Seals. And you talked about catching those as a kid, didn't you?
Yeah. Actually, I caught many of them. So it was actually pretty neat to read that article and think back when I was a little tyke running around the woods trying to catch everything I possibly could and bring it home and have mom say, nope, got to let it go.
Yeah, exactly. Nope, got to go.
So.
And really looking forward to the next issue of Herphouse, of course.
Yeah, when does that come out, by the way?
I believe it's on the 30th, if I'm not mistaken.
Great. So a couple more weeks and we get a new issue to read, huh?
Yeah, a couple more weeks, be a new issue out. A lot of stuff from various authors around the world, actually. We have some more authors coming in from the UK that are sharing a lot of tips and tricks that they've learned throughout the industry and stuff like that this month. Kim LaForce is going to be back in there. Ron Tremper's back in there already. All the regular columns are going to be in there. You know, and don't forget, also, we also have the affiliate program. So our affiliates out there are available to provide discounts for you. There's a 30% discount codes running around out there from various affiliates and stuff like that. It's 100% digital, no advertisement in the magazine except for a single page in the back, which is a business card size ad. The rest of it's just content. So that's pretty much Herphouse Mag in a nutshell.
Cool. Sounds like we got a pretty cool issue coming out. I can't wait to read it. And I still need to get you my column. Been so busy around here, I don't even have that sent to you yet.
Well, that you have to talk to the boss about. I don't have anything to do with any column writing or anything like that. I just, you know, do some editorial work, write an article once in a while, and that's about as far as I get with it.
Right. Well, hey, I got a shout-out for this week. I actually want to promote Rocca, rocca.net. They have an auction going on. Buy your tickets. It ends on July 4th, so make sure you go and buy your tickets. It's raaca.net. Tickets are $20 a piece. Just go buy some tickets. It's a huge prize set. I think $35,000 worth of stuff. So, and it's $20 a ticket. All the proceeds go to USARC on this one. So go by there and check it out and buy your tickets. You got anything you want to promote this week there, John?
Of course. We have mentioned our wonderful sponsors, Happy Gecko Sticky Happy Gecko Sticky Situation. Jeez, James.
I'm not the only one that's tongue-tied on that.
Sorry, Rachel. I apologize. I'll mention you again at the end of the show. Do check out her Etsy shop. She's creating a lot of really killer magnets, stickers. Gosh, it seems like she's just constantly creating new different products and things. And she was talking about, I think she mentioned something about possibly creating T-shirts very soon.
Yeah, I thought I saw that come across my screen too as well on Facebook.
Yeah, so I'm really interested to see what she comes up with next. And I do know she shared, in regards to a hognose, she got the approval. She had drawn some hognose, I believe it was an Eastern hognose, for a specific herb society.
Virginia.
Was it Virginia? Okay.
The Virginia Herb society. Yep.
Okay. And, yeah, she got the final approval for a job well done on that, so congratulations there. And, yeah, check her out, Happy Gecko Sticky Situation. And that's the only shout-out that I have besides Raka. I know all their stuff goes towards US ARC, so definitely support those guys as well.
Yeah, so actually we got a pretty good show today. Actually, really interesting show today.
Yeah, something, to say the least.
Something that we kind of stepped out of the whole hobby biz type show and really, to put it in plain words, tickled my fancy. And after talking to our guests, and especially Crystal, really made me think differently about how we keep animals and also how the animals interact with us out in the wild. So it's definitely going to be a great show. You got any words before we introduce our guest there, John?
You know, I just liked it because actually I met Crystal via Twitter, if I'm not mistaken. It was kind of a random thing. She had posted something about, you know, iguanas and film in the same sentence, and it obviously, you know, you say anything reptile related in filming and I'm on it. You know, I want to know more about it. Who are you? Where did you come from? And why are you filming iguanas? I must know. And you know, we shared some, you know, just general conversation really. And through the course of conversation, we were just like, wow, we share a lot of the same ideals. You do some really interesting work. We need to get this out there. And next thing you know, there's a Kickstarter campaign to help fund the whole project. We've told all of our fans about it because it's, like you said, it tickles our fancy. It's just a really interesting project that's never not been covered in the way that Crystal and her team are doing it, for sure. It's looking at both not just the reptile behaviors, but also the human behaviors as they interact with the reptiles. So it's a really, yeah, you just have to listen to the whole interview just to get it all.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's something that's hardly ever covered in herpetoculture world.
I've never seen it.
Nobody
covered.
Ever talks about something like this, and it always goes behind the scenes and always catch the production long 2-3 years after it's been made, and then it comes across my screen, and I'm like, oh, wow, that was pretty cool. When did that come out? 4 years ago. So I'm glad to be, you know, right here and learning about it as it comes out, because I think it's something herpetoculture needs to start keeping their eyes open for, because it'll help us out in the long run too.
Yeah, for sure.
So go ahead, John, introduce our guest tonight.
Okay, so let's see here. Where do we start? Jeez. I guess we should start with Crystal Fortwangler first. Crystal, welcome to the show. How are you this evening?
I'm great. Thank you. Thanks for having us. And I love the introduction already, so I'm looking forward to the rest.
So, Crystal, basically give us a quick synopsis of what you're doing with the project and your background as far as how you got involved with all this.
Thanks. So I have two roles. I'm a university professor, and I teach in a school of sustainability, and I bring my background, which is looking at how people interact with animals, how animals interact with humans, And, of course, we're all animals. But across that spectrum, the different perspectives, worldviews, religious perspectives, just a whole range of ways in which we interact with different animals. And so I publish a lot on that topic, and I'm part of a field called animal-human studies, also referred to as interspecies studies or interspecies interactions. And then the second part of my life is that I make films, and so I've recently started a film company with my partner, who's based in Tel Aviv, and he's an underwater filmmaker. And we came together to create a company that looks at the relationship between sustainability and conservation, and also animal welfare. So what does it mean for animals caught up in the mix, right? So humans live, we change and shape the world, we always have, we always will, but how do we interact together moving forward and thinking about that interaction? And so then in the Virgin Islands, where I've been doing research for about 15 years. I've studied the history of the natural resources there, especially in National Park, but I looked at donkeys, always thinking about animals. And so most recently, I started studying iguanas. And so that's how I came into the iguana story in the Virgin Islands. And so that's a general background. I would say, you know, one of the most important pieces of the conversation for me and to think beyond St. John is that globally, people and animals have always moved together, always. I mean, you know, move a person, a seed comes along, a plant, or we've taken animals with us. Maybe animals have moved on their own, but there's always been an interaction. And as we move into the 21st century, that's accelerating. That the data shows this. And how do we think about this moving forward? So there's more movement of people. So, for example, one of the most intense conversations right now is the number of species that are moving into Antarctica on, say, the shoes of people when they move. So a lot of now people are having to take off all their clothes, put them in bags, wash off before they can go into certain areas. So we move species. And with climate change, any other number of factors, habitat destruction, I mean, we move around animals. And so how do we think about when we end up with more animals in one place or less animals in one place? So this is a topic and a conversation. So in the Virgin Islands, as your viewers may have seen, there's an increasing number of iguanas, way more than there used to be. And so why is that? And how do we think about ourselves but also the animals when we start making decisions moving forward? Because I love animals, and I like to try to think about that in the context of sustainability as well. So that's me in a nutshell.
Awesome.
10 minutes worth of a nutshell.
Very intriguing and very interesting. I definitely want to touch on some of the topics that you mentioned in the conversation as far as humans traveling with species and things of that nature, because I've read something similar. David Quammen, Song of the Dodo, was talking about, you know, some of the impacts and things of that nature. So I like how you're thinking about it, and I definitely want to cover that later on in the interview as well. So next, I would like to bring up, I believe it's Jessica Bellis. Okay, and if Jessica, there she is. Hi, Jessica,
yep.
How are you?
Thanks. Doing good.
Awesome. So how did you become involved in this specific project? It's not easy being green.
I've been friends with Crystal for 25 years. I've known her since college, and I have been traveling with her to the Virgin Islands for a variety of research projects and frankly, just hanging out on the beach too, right? You know, it's a fun place to visit. So, you know, and so a couple summers ago, I went down with her to actually count iguanas, and I was involved in that, and then it sort of evolved into a film project. So we were doing a population study, and then we kind of wanted to take it to the next level. So then we were deciding what to do, and we thought a documentary would be the best way to go. And, you know, the changing moment for me when we made that decision was we were I was actually staying at a large hotel, I won't name which one, and they had an iguana overpopulation problem at this hotel. It was fueled because they had a program where the tourists could feed the iguanas. And I was just walking back to my room one day, and I saw these hotel employees just putting them in a bag. I mean, they were literally throwing these iguanas in a bag, you know, several iguanas, and I became very upset. I just didn't like seeing that. And so, you know, I told Crystal about it, and, you know, we kind of talked about it, and it became a news story, and it was really sort of... I didn't like how, you know, some people were treating them. They're animals. They shouldn't be treated like that. So then it kind of became a documentary. So it's been a great project to be involved in. So I've really enjoyed it.
Now, see, something you mentioned, and I just want to mention it to our audience, for any of those out there that have asked us in the past about, you know, should we go to college, should we not go to college for herpetology, this and the other thing. Did you catch what Jessica just said? She made friends in college, and she got a job counting iguanas in, you know, the Virgin Islands. Come on, guys. Go to college. It's really worth it, because where else can you get a job counting iguanas in the Virgin Islands?
It's a great job to have, and it's all about who you know, right?
Exactly. So I was.
It's true. Exactly. You know, and also I was an iguana owner for a number of years as well, and I think Crystal might have become acquainted with iguanas through my pet iguana. So I've had a very long history with them, so just wanted to add that as well.
Okay, very cool. And now we're going to bring on Renata. And Renata, I'm not even going to try to pronounce the last name because I know I'll probably murder it, so I'll just let you pronounce it if you don't mind.
Oh, sorry, I'm a little slow. I'm a little slow. We have a slow connection here in the islands. My name's Renata Plattenberg, and I am a herpetologist, or more specifically, I'm a reptile ecologist. And I've taken a very long journey to get to the Virgin Islands that have included the Galapagos Islands and England and Germany and Colorado and Utah. And I came to the islands 10 years ago to work as I came for a job as the wildlife biologist with the state, the Territorial Wildlife Agency, the Department of Planning and Natural Resources, Division of Fish and Wildlife. And I have been involved with this iguana question because I'm the one that gets the phone calls from people like Jessica and saying that she's seen these things happening with iguanas, and I get the phone calls from the hotel saying, you have to help us get rid of the iguanas, and my job is as natural resource manager is to try and figure out what we should do about this, and so that's how I got involved in this project.
Very cool, very cool. Alright, now, let's see, basically I guess, so some of the just generalized questions, are iguanas even native to St. John's, do we know?
So the green iguanas are not native to the Virgin Islands. They were introduced by humans at some point in their history here. There is a native iguana, the West Indian cyclura iguanas, or rock iguanas, that you might have heard, the blue iguanas from the Cayman Islands and the Bahamas. Those are native to the Caribbean, and the Virgin Islands does have a native species, although it's entire native range is restricted to Anegada, which is on the eastern side of the British Virgin Islands. The green iguanas were introduced by humans, but the big question is when they were introduced. There's a possibility that they were pre-Columbian introductions, that they traveled up from the South America with the indigenous people. That's not the case with the iguanas, the green iguanas in Puerto Rico. They were definitely a more recent introduction. They came through the pet trade.
Okay. Then how were we able to identify where these iguanas came from and how they were, you know, how do we know that they came from with the people versus they didn't just, you know, travel there themselves? How do we know that people brought them along?
Yeah, that's a really good question, and we don't really have that answer. We know that the iguanas have been in the Virgin Islands for a very long time. I believe Crystal can talk more about this. She's done some literature studies and have found references to iguanas dating back to the 1700s on St. John. I think to really get the definitive answer of where, how our iguanas are related to other populations of iguanas from mainland and other islands, we really need to look at the genetics.
Okay. And Crystal?
I'll echo a bit of what Renata said and then throw some additional questions and conversations in. You know, it gets right to the heart of the question of how do we decide what native is, what isn't. You know, there are official definitions that federal agencies use to make those decisions. And, you know, I'm more familiar with the National Park Service, but Renata, jump in if it seems different than how your agency used to work for dealt with that. Has it been introduced by humans? And so that's often one of the clearer lines that people look to make that decision. But as Renata indicated, we weren't there. We don't know. The best sense that we have is that makes sense, that they were introduced by people through that chain. But there's also, one or two studies that show iguanas having floated from one island to another. But we don't know for certain. And so her point to DNA is really the clearest and strongest possibility to have solid answers. What's fascinating to me, and this just throws a whole other sort of piece into it, is that in the U.S. Virgin Islands in the 1920s, they passed a law that specifically protects iguanas. They also protected an animal called an agouti, so it was the Aguda and Iguana law. It's not entirely clear why they passed that law, because records have been burnt in a fire, so we can't really see the dialogue between the senators at the time. But they protected it. It doesn't list it as native, but it lists it as it's illegal to kill it, harm it, or relocate it. Renata knows that law well. So you have this protected status. It doesn't list it as a native or not. But how do we make those decisions? And so just to give the dates that Renata was talking about, and we can talk about the law a bit more in a minute, but just to get the background to it, we're certain that green iguanas were in the Virgin Islands since 1862, and we know that because there was a study by a well-known herpetologist and naturalist at the time, Reinhardt and Lupton, and they showed clearly iguanas on all three islands. Now, where did those iguanas come from? Right. These are the kind of questions that we're not 100% able to show. There's also reference back to 1777 of iguanas in the islands, but that comes from a Moravian missionary, so depending on what kind of data you like to secure as how you make your argument, but there is even a further reference back. My understanding was that the laws from the 1920s, the original legislation that I've seen, Renata, but there have been amendments or additions added on through like wildlife protection laws that are later. You might have more updated information about the law.
So my understanding of the law was that it came into, and I really didn't think that it was 1920s because the Virgin Islands wasn't really, it was purchased by the U.S. in the
1917.
Yeah. So I don't know when the VI code came into place and when those laws came into place. And I thought that the Iguana and Goody Act was something that was more 1980s. But nevertheless, whenever it was put into place, it was it specifically identifies iguanas and agoutis, neither of which, so an agouti is a small rodent native to South America. And these two animals are frequently eaten. They're very common items of diet of people in various parts of Central America and South America. And I really thought that it was David Nellis that created this law to protect the iguanas because they thought that there weren't very many of them. They thought they considered them to be native, they being the local wildlife department of the conservation agency at the time. They saw that they were endangered, and they started moving the iguanas around from island to island. And so this law says you can't kill them or harm them, and if you do kill them or harm them, then whatever you use to kill them with can be confiscated, and you'll be fined $50. So as a government employee, which then I'm no longer, I'm now at the university, but I was following around fancy cars hoping that they would run into an iguana so that I could confiscate a nice car.
Nice.
I understand that law, though, I have heard through the grapevine that law has been repealed because the iguanas have increased in numbers in recent years and have become a problem for local residents, specifically the hotels and people that have spend a lot of money on ornamental plants and also in the agricultural areas. And so they've been very vocal about their issues with the iguana, and I understand, I haven't looked up the law to make sure that it has been revoked, but I understand that the recent Senate has pulled that law off the books.
Yeah, I'll check that most recent piece out, but I do have the legislation from the 1920s, Renata, so it was a conversation that was happening then. There's been additional pieces that have been added on later, but the original pieces, I can send that to you. It was passed earlier.
Okay, cool.
I actually have a question. So if we know the iguanas were on the island in 1862, we can only guess that they weren't from the pet trade. I mean, did we have a pet trade in 1862?
Well, no. I think that was my point. Oh, I'm sorry. No, I think that was my point earlier, that the iguanas from Puerto Rico were definitely part of the pet trade, whereas we don't believe that the iguanas in the Virgin Islands were part of the pet trade.
Okay.
And really clear physical differences between the two populations of iguanas, what they look like, and I think I will let Crystal talk about this.
Yeah, no, that's more or less the understanding that I have. And there are very different laws or regulations in place, different in Puerto Rico than in the Virgin Islands, and especially when you look at the phenotypical characteristics of the iguanas. That said, though, there are certain islands in Puerto Rico where you can see more similarities between the iguanas in the U.S. Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. And so this gets to that great question. Now you'll get me super excited, and whoever over there likes to think about native and what's not native. This is such a fabulous case when you look at, and I know we were talking earlier about DNA and thinking about, you know, even your audience or how people, you know, think about where their iguanas are from. You know, let's say that we had iguanas. Well, we know we had iguanas in the Virgin Islands at least back to 1862, unless someone wants to fight with, you know, this famous herpetologist. So are the iguanas that are in the Virgin Islands today directly, you know, descended of those iguanas? Probably, or maybe some of them, maybe not. At any point, we know other iguanas have come in. Maybe they got there themselves. Maybe someone from Puerto Rico brought some. Someone from other islands brought some. There are iguanas. Iguana is across so many islands, and not to mention many other species of iguanas. But how do we know which iguana came from where, and did they mix? I mean, Renata, would you say that that sounds about right?
Oh, absolutely. I would guess that our original 1800s population is very different. Is a very small relic in the existing population of iguanas that have probably, I mean, certainly they've been moved between the three islands and the Virgin Islands, but they're likely also have been added to from Puerto Rico and various other locations as well.
And this gets right to the question of when you're deciding about native as an interesting conversation piece, right? What if a species was there and then the species is gone because of, you know, habitat loss or whatever? That species comes back 50 years later, but it's a different population. You know, how do people decide if that's still a native population or not? I don't know the answer to that. Renata, do you?
Yeah, it's certainly something that we grapple with when thinking about island conservation. You know, the Caribbean is an area of very, very high biodiversity, and the reason for that is because of these isolated populations that have been isolated for millions of years, and genetic drift has allowed speciation to occur up and down the island chain. And so all these islands have really, really unique assemblages of species that are similar on each island, but genetically very, very different. And in many cases, ecologically and physiologically very, very different. And so the aim of conservation biologists is to maintain that really unique genetic diversity on each of these islands, but that really becomes compounded when people are moving animals around. And also helping animals move around by having increased movement of things, of ships and cargo between islands.
Right, which leads us right to a great question of whether there's anyone out there who wants to study DNA in the Virgin Islands of iguanas.
I was just going to get to that. So there's currently, as of you ladies know, there's currently nobody working with the DNA studies of the iguanas, the whole iguana species itself. There's no DNA studies going on at all?
I met a lady at a conference once who was doing genetic studies, looking at phylogeography of green iguana, and I talked to her at length about the Virgin Islands, and she wasn't interested. So I don't think there is anyone that's doing any studies on the green iguanas.
Yeah, I mean, really, you would think that you would actually grab DNA from every iguana on Earth to put it all into the study. I mean, whether you believe it floated over on a raft from another population or, you know, it was brought over by humans, you would think you would want to know exactly where they land. It's kind of strange with iguanas being so popular why nobody's really done the whole entire study. And if there's anybody out there listening or watching, if you know somebody that's working on it, please contact me at reptilelivingroom.com or on Facebook and let me know so I can get you guys in touch with these three ladies and you guys can correlate back and forth, because they're really interested in knowing the DNA part of the iguanas on all the islands. So if we can help anybody out, that'd be a great way to do so.
Yeah, and I'll just say, I mean, it matters significantly for policymakers to have the best data that they can. You know, if an animal, you know, in the Virgin Islands, it's protected by law, unless, you know, as Renata said, this is most recently shifted. You know, it makes a difference on how decisions are made. You can still have a native species that's invasive, though, as well. And so this is another piece to keep in mind, is it's not only about whether something's native or not native. It's how do we think about these animals and their environments. And anyone who's interested in that topic, there's a great debate in ecology right now, and especially a piece that was published in Nature called Don't Judge Species on Their Origins, and it was led by Mark Davis and a number of other scholars, asking us to think about how we assess organisms on environmental impact rather than on whether they're natives or not. And that's not to say that that's not an important conversation to me or to anybody else, but as we move forward, when we have so much mixing going on, how do resource managers make decisions about which animals or which species to deal with? Is it only based on whether they say it's native or not native, versus what kind of impact is actually happening in the system?
Well, that comes to another question I have, too, is even if it is an alien species and it fits into an ecosystem or into a place that doesn't harm anything else or any native species, where does conservation and draw the line on laws there? Or how do you know, is the iguana really causing a massive lot of trouble with the native species, or is it more so the humans?
Well, so that's a really, really good question, and that's one of the things that I've spent a lot of time in the Virgin Islands since I've been here examining, is what is the impact of non-native species on native species, and not just the iguanas. I've been looking at, I've put a lot of effort into looking at frogs, because a good 30% of our frog population is non-native invasive, and same species that are highly problematic elsewhere, and I'm kind of finding that they're not causing the same impacts here that they're causing in other places, and that's because there's not a tremendous amount of potential food items or competition for these organisms. So they're eating different things than the natives. They're not eating the natives as much. However, what I have been unable to quantify is the impacts that these organisms are having on other organisms that I'm not particularly looking at, such as the invertebrates, birds, and other organisms. So there was a study on the coqui frog, Eleutherodactylus coqui. It's native to Puerto Rico, and interestingly enough, even though the Virgin Islands is on the Puerto Rican bank, this species is not native to the Virgin Islands. And the coqui is considered locally endangered in Puerto Rico. It's declining for various reasons. It as well has been introduced to Hawaii, where it's tremendously abundant and causing huge amounts of problems in Hawaii, mainly because it's very, very noisy. But so they've done studies in Hawaii where they do not have native amphibians, so there's not something that it's competing with directly. But it turns out that they've been able to quantify the number of insects that this frog eats in several hundreds of thousands per organism, per hectare, per time period, whatever, which has a tremendous amount of impact on the native birds in Hawaii. So you put those organisms here, and we do have competition with frogs, and so the coqui frog, even though it's native to the Puerto Rican bank, it turns out that that's one of the most problematic species that we have here. So the iguana, it seems innocuous, but we don't really know what impact it might be having on systems that we're not actually looking at. So the answer is we don't know.
Yeah, and then just additionally to that, as Renata points out in the film, you know, most of the impact and sort of struggle or tension happens mostly and especially in areas where humans are, human living spaces. Iguanas love the environments that we create. They're quite happy in our spaces. There's some great research, if anyone's interested, that came out of Puerto Rico a couple of years ago, that shows iguanas highly tolerant of people, actually in some cases prefer human-altered spaces. And that, you know, there's a variety of reasons for that. As Renata points out in the film as well, you know, iguanas like to come where there's food. And so if you've got a lot of mango trees and they're dropping, and you've got yards full of fruit trees or exotic plants that you've brought in that they like, villas, pools, you know, this is like iguana paradise. If anyone's been to the Virgin Islands, you have a sense of how some of the landscaping is designed there. So we have this increase in iguanas. There are a variety of reasons, but certainly we create environments that we like. Another quick reason just to throw out is there are questions about sand that comes in from other islands for construction purposes. So you could essentially have a sand transported that has some iguana eggs in it. Iguana eggs are sturdier than turtle eggs. I think, I know your audience probably knows better than me. Maybe y'all do. But iguana eggs transport relatively, they're stronger is my understanding. And there have been some anecdotal stories of construction people seeing iguanas come out of sand. I mean, we don't have direct evidence of that. Again, DNA samples would be fabulous.
All right, fair enough. Now, in regards to the public and the interaction with the iguanas, I want to throw it out to Jessica, because you had your first encounter there with the hotel iguana, and that's something I wanted to bring up because I actually saw it on, I don't know, Travel Channel or some other cable network, you know, travel leisure show, where the gentleman was talking about this hotel, and they had this whole colony of iguanas where the chefs actually went out every day and prepared feasts for the iguanas. And it showed them going out, you know, and hand feeding the iguanas, and the guests were encouraged to, you know, go out and feed the iguanas. And the whole time in the back of my head, I'm thinking, that's not the brightest thing you guys could have ever done, because now you're just going to increase the population because it's just standard biological procedure. Food increases, population increases.
Right, exactly. And that was the problem at the major hotel chain that I mentioned earlier, right? I mean, as I said, I was very fortunate that I've been traveling with Crystal to the Virgin Islands for a number of years. And so this hotel chain had an event where they would allow the tourists to feed the iguanas, right? And so every year we'd go back, there'd be more and more iguanas. We saw, you know, children get bit by iguanas. And then the last time I was there, they stopped that event. But then they're trying to control the population, and that's when I saw them putting these iguanas in a bag, and they were like three large, like 4-foot iguanas in one bag. So you know, it was a tourist attraction for a while, but then when it became out of control, then they wanted to just kind of dispose of it. But you know, from the tourist's perspective, you know, as the film's production coordinator. You know, one of the things I was tasked with was, you know, Crystal asked me to find a tourist who really liked iguanas, and that was not very difficult. The first tourist I found wanted to be interviewed and wanted to be in the film. You know, every store in St. John has little iguana stuffed animals, iguana postcards, iguana figurines. There's a number of stores named after iguanas. There, you know, I mean, it's definitely a tourist attraction. That, you know, is definitely bringing some revenue in. And, you know, the tourist that I interviewed for the movie, she said she's going to come back to St. John every single year because she so enjoys that interaction with the iguanas. So, you know, there's definitely a tourist element that attracts people to the island because of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'll add as well, you know, in the film we have two hotel managers talking about this exact question. You know, their tourists love the iguanas. You know, whatever we decide about native, not native, when, how, the reality on the ground today is that tourists love iguanas on St. John. Not necessarily the residents. some do and some don't. It's like a love-hate relationship in many ways for residents. But, you know, most tourists generally, and that's reflected, again, in the tourist industry. You see lots of sales of iguana pieces. But the hotels specifically have to try to figure out how can they coexist with iguanas on their property because they recognize the value to their guests. And then many of them also just happen to, I mean, they like iguanas as well. And So how can they create environments there that the iguanas aren't eating the every plant that they have on the property gone and they have to change it? One of the hotels had to add in a, I don't know, can I say poop on the air? Like a poop manager, because they have to go around now two or three times a day and just scoop up the excrement around the hotel because there are that many iguanas. And so, you know, they're doing that, but they're also amazingly doing lots of experiments on the properties to see how they can put certain kind of plants in that the iguanas won't go for. Iguanas love, Renata will know more about this, but I mean, they love to eat young plants, is that right? Like they're attracted often to certain kinds of plants. And so I know Renata has a lot of suggestions, as she does in the film, for people about how to reduce iguanas if you don't want them on property.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so I first got involved with hotels when one of the major hotel chains had spent huge, huge thousands and thousands of dollars and had gone in and planted their ornamentals over a course of a week. And so they started on Monday and they finished on Friday. And by Saturday afternoon, the iguanas had eaten everything. And it was very, very rapid, and it was very, very devastating, and it was very upsetting to the hotel, clearly. And they sent their landscape manager to me, and I spent a long time researching it. I looked at what people in other places were doing, and kind of came up with some really general basic guidelines. So iguanas are going to eat the little soft plants, the baby plants, because they're very, very tasty. And the more money that you've spent on it, the more the iguanas are going to enjoy eating it, really. And then they're going to go and visit the swimming pool. And as reptile keepers, we all know what happens when reptiles enter a pool of water, and these are the same pools that the hotel guests are staying in, swimming in, and in some cases, the hotel guests are spending upwards of $500 a night for the privilege of swimming in this water. So yeah, it's not cheap, and so the hotels really, really, really wanted to find a solution to this, and they were very, very resistant to my insistence that they do not, in fact, bag up the iguanas and take them elsewhere, because by removing the iguanas, what they're doing is they're creating a void, and they're enabling other iguanas to move in. And so if you have, you know, your big male iguanas, they do maintain, they do clump around, and you can, the hotels can maintain very, very large populations of iguanas. But when you start removing the big territorial ones, you'll get twice as many will move in. So right. You've taken your big ones out, you've put them somewhere else, so now you have two problems. You have the iguanas moving into the area that you just cleared, and then you have the iguanas someplace else that are starting over and eating everything over there. And so my recommendations were really geared towards the hotels working with the iguanas that they have, while at the same time protecting the resources that they need to protect. And we came up with some different ideas. Some of them didn't really work very well. Some of them worked better than others. And it really is something that's case by case and amount of effort that the hotel and groundspeople are willing to put into it every week.
For sure. Now, as you said, and as I'm sure Jessica as well knows, I owned also a free-roaming iguana for a couple of years, and by free-roaming meaning he just, you know, wandered around the house and just did whatever the heck he felt like doing that day. I didn't have but one area of carpet, mind you. But still, it's like when I see this, the public being allowed to feed the amount of iguanas that are out there. And the other aspect of this is I'm also on the hotel side, too, because I worked in a dog kennel for numerous years. So I know what it feels like to be that poop manager. And it's like, how do we strike the balance, I guess, is, you know, can we maybe use herpetoculture to our advantage by capturing, you know, some of the iguanas and, you know, moving them into herpetoculture somehow? I mean, what are your guys' thoughts on that?
You buy a big pressure washer, John. That's my answer to the poop cleanup. Just a big pressure washer.
Well, I think, I mean, Renata, you had just spoken to that. I mean, when you pull them out, no matter, right, because I often hear this as a suggestion when in the production of the film when we ask people for solutions. You know, you'll often hear either put them in a zoo-like environment, maybe in the middle of town so that people can come and look at them, or I often hear, and this is a, you know, at first it seems like a quite reasonable conversation, right, is that iguanas, iguana in certain places is, I don't know, maybe threatened or at least reduced populations because of habitat loss. So people will often suggest in the case, let's move them, let's relocate them to another place. But, you know, there's the points that Renata is raising, which is that you still haven't dealt with the existing population in that place. And so even pulling them out into herpetoculture, I don't know if you would still be dealing with the question on the ground. Is that right, Renata?
So I think the other thing that we can bring into this conversation now is that who it is that lives here in the Virgin Islands and who you might be offering these iguanas to as potential pets. The local community really, really not. So the Virgin Islands people, the West Indian community, are really, really not fond of iguanas or really any wild animal. They do not like them. They do not embrace them. They absolutely do not like the iguanas. The tourists love the iguanas, and for that reason, certainly the iguanas around the hotels are tolerated to a point. But the local community, they are absolutely horrified and terrified by these iguanas. Small ones, big ones, they just do not like them. So it wouldn't really be very useful to offer these iguanas as pets to these people. They are so loath of these animals that they won't even consider eating them like they do in other places. And I don't know if the stateside iguana community can really support the amount of iguanas that we would be sending from this island.
Right, there are quite a lot. In the film, you can see, even in the trailer, you know, one woman has a third of an acre with 100 iguanas on it. But I will, you know, as a good cultural anthropologist here, jump in and add to Renata. You know, in my experience across a lot of populations in the Virgin Islands, I mean, people that I've interviewed for the film who are from the States, you know, I have one person who uses a shotgun to kill as many as he can, you know. So there's also, depending on who it is, also some animosity towards the animals as well. I have another person who kills them with BB guns regularly each month or knives. I mean, and those people come from the States as well. So I think that, you know, it's often also what kind of situation an individual is faced with the iguanas. We also have some people in the film who are from the Virgin Islands who love them and embrace them and, you know, really, but, you know, on the whole, I understand what you're saying, Renata. I mean, on the whole, there's not a history of particularly embracing the iguanas as, you know, sort of in a personal space or in that kind of way.
Or really any of the wild animals that we have here. There's really a very lack of connection to those animals. And I think that sentiment is much stronger on St. Thomas than on St. John, because it's a larger population. You have more people from different Caribbean islands here as well.
Right, and it's also true that, you know, this question about eating iguanas, this is often a solution. This comes up throughout the film, is, you know, there are a number of people who offer a suggestion that we would be able, that people would be able to eat the iguana to reduce the population or as a local, you know, supply of protein, because if anyone's familiar with the Virgin Islands, much of the protein sources are imported. If you think you're eating fish from the local environment when you step into most restaurants, that's not always the case. You know, there's a lot of importation of food into the Virgin Islands, and so, but this idea, one, of lizards, You know, this is uncomfortable for many people, let alone even for myself. I'm a vegetarian. You know, I'm not going to eat the iguana. So, you know, is this a viable conversation moving forward? For some people it is, and for some people it's not.
Well, I can jump in with the whole concept of the chickens. We have a huge population of feral chickens, probably as many or more feral chickens than there are feral iguanas. And the local people, their number one choice of food is Kentucky Fried Chicken, but they will not eat the feral chickens. They just won't eat the feral chickens at all. So there's a lot of cultural attitudes to understand and address before you can really start to deal with the problem.
So Jessica, as the production coordinator, what are some of the cultural attitudes that you've run into specifically? You know, because you were the person running around, you know, talking to people, and so what did you find?
Right. Well, as Crystal was saying, I mean, the attitudes are very varied from our perspective. You know, one of the longtime residents of St. John, you know, who owns a bar and restaurant, I mean, loves them. You know, we have footage of her in her yard, you know, with, you know, feeding them. You know, but then she also has sort of a mixed view because they're killing all of her trees. You know, the tourists, though, like we said, I mean, they really, you know, the tourists love them, but, you know, they can leave, right? They don't have to deal with the day in and day out effects. You know, the things that I witnessed at the hotel, you know, trying to control the population weren't necessarily so great. You know, but I'd say that the residents that we interviewed for the film were fairly mixed, you know, as far as having to deal with them. But, you know, the tourists love them. Like I said, you know, Crystal asked me to go find some tourists that, you know, that we could interview who liked the iguanas, and that was the easiest task I had during the whole thing because it was not hard. The tourists love them. So, you know, very mixed.
Okay, fair enough. Now, do you find, and I'm trying to make sure I say this right because I know Crystal's listening intently, being a cultural anthropologist.
Take my mic off. We always do that. That's what cultural anthropologists do.
Because I'm interested in your experience as far as European, basically like from Spain and Europe, that kind of thing. Do you see a difference in, I guess, racial attitudes towards reptiles at all? Meaning the tourists coming in are not from the island itself. Do you see any differences as far as opinions that way? In other words, the tourists that don't like the iguanas there?
Yeah, this is a really good question that you're asking. You know, from where I stand, to me, it appears to be cultural. And then within that, though, there's variation, right? So if you're familiar with the world of iguanas and you step into the Virgin Islands, you know, like the woman who's in the film, one of the main tourists, you know, her daughter has had reptiles, I think, for a while, Jess. And I mean, she loves them. She steps into a space, she's excited, she engages them. But there are some tourists, right, because the hotel managers tell this as well, that are flipped out by them. I mean, they don't want to go anywhere near them. They run. They're, you know, they're screaming, get this lizard away from me. So we see that. But I would say on the whole, there's probably an interest, because I think there's also somewhat of an exoticism to this, or like a prehistoric sort of animal that people show up and they're like, wow, I'm on an island. And I, you know, so it adds in, you know, and Renata mentioned other wildlife and animals on the island. You know, people, if you're driving around St. John, you might crash into a tourist who stopped to look at the donkeys. They might even be looking at the chickens crossing the road. I mean, you have no, you know, people come and they're looking, right. And then residents, you know, and Renata's point is taken on this. I mean, for many people, there weren't a lot of iguanas in their world growing up, right? So, like, this increase in iguanas is more prevalent in the last 20 or 30 years or so. You know, back in the 40s, 50s, there was a much smaller population. They weren't in people's worlds as much versus other island communities. So you certainly get people who are run and scared and don't want to be a part of iguanas, and, you know, we have someone in the film running from them. But you'll also find people, of course, like you would anywhere, who have an affinity for them and engage. So I would say no, I don't see any sort of, race specific or even ethnicity, but that there's variation.
That's what I'm looking for, ethnicity bias. Is what
there's variations.
Okay. Now, another question that actually our executive producer, Chad, brought up was, do we actually have a number of how many iguanas are actually there? What do we have the population studies and things of that nature?
I think between Renata and I will be able to answer this. I started with some... Go ahead, sorry?
A lot.
Yeah, go ahead. Why don't you start?
No, I just said a lot. We have a lot of iguanas, and we haven't really quantified how many we have, but certainly... I'll let you address this because you guys did that work on St. John.
Yeah, Jessica can talk more about her actual experience out in the field because that's a fun thing to think about, especially if people are interested. Like I think maybe some of the people here on the panel are to come count iguanas with us. There hasn't been a full-scale study of iguana numbers in the Virgin Islands. However, there's been some movement towards that. So 2 or 3 years ago, I worked with a herpetologist from Puerto Rico and an ecologist from Puerto Rico, and we did some initial studies, but those aren't the kind of things that we can publish in a scientific journal just yet. There needs to be more research done. However, that said, the initial pieces that came out of that study for St. John, right? So there's St. Thomas, St. Croix, but for St. John, we know that they're more heavily populated in the areas outside of the national park. I mean, there was serious sampling done. We did a lot of data collection. They know what they're doing. But again, it's not quite at that point where you would publish it. But certainly the early indications show that, and Renata pointed to this earlier and in the film, is that they're not heavily populated within the Virgin Islands National Park at this moment. And that makes some sense. Iguanas like edge environments. You know, they enjoy being in mangroves. They're not deep wooded, high mountain top animals. And so the Virgin Islands National Park is much that. So you don't really see them in the park in such high quantities. They might be there, right, but they're not dominant. Versus, you go into the areas in St. John where there are communities living, we see much higher rates. Now that varies, right? So in some parts of the island there's more, in other parts there are less. And here's to Renata's point specifically, is that people relocate them, and this is why it's so important to get the word out about what to do and what not to do with iguanas if you're looking to decrease the population versus, I know of certain cases, a number of people picking the iguanas up from one side of the island and taking them to the other side of the island and dumping them. In fact, we know that it's happened even with the hotel that we were talking about earlier. There has been relocation. And, it comes from a good place, I think. I don't think it comes from a place to... In fact, often trying to help the animal, right? Like, okay, it's not going to make it here. Let's take it somewhere else. Or I don't want this many. And you end up with more. And so on St. John, what you start to see is increasing numbers of iguanas in other parts of the island. Now, maybe the iguanas got there themselves that fast, but I doubt it, especially because I know for certain that people have relocated them. Renata, do you have more on that?
Wow.
I know for certain that people have relocated them, and I know that it happens all the time because I think people are aware that iguanas are considered endangered, so they know that they might get in trouble for killing them, although it doesn't really stop them from killing them. But on St. Thomas, as St. Thomas has become more and more developed, and there really are very, very few areas of St. Thomas that are not developed, and so the iguanas really are incredibly abundant on St. Thomas because of that. They're as where the humans go, that's where the iguanas go as well.
No, Renata, have you found that this species, specific species of iguana, is adapting or possibly adapting to live with humans in better formats or at all? Or is that something you haven't seen yet? Or is it just that's a typical iguana thing in the wild as they live on disturbed habitat?
Yeah, so that's a good question because, you know, the iguanas that we're talking about here are not native iguanas, and so they will behave differently from native species in their natural environment. And so characteristics of non-native animals that are very successful are animals that are able to take advantage of weedy environments and able to take advantage of environments that humans offer. We grow fruit trees, we plant flowers, we have trash and stuff, and the iguanas really do very, very well around humans.
I just want to add, you know, I still like to maybe think that some iguanas got there themselves, but let's get some, I would like some of the students out there to join us. but also, importantly, to add to what Renata was just saying, is that, you know, let's just say that some of these iguanas have been there since the late 1700s. You know, when you look at an ecosystem or niches or how it's changed over time, you know, how much does time matter, doesn't it? I mean, that's a great question. I don't really know the answer to that, but I would like to, you know, Renata, if you have some thoughts on that, you know, how long does an animal need to be there? Because, you know, in the film you talk about the iguana is managed as if it's a native at this point, for management purposes, right? So how do you sort of fit that into the conversation?
Yeah, so that's a really tough question. So we're going back to that whole question about what's native and what's not native. And, you know, you mentioned earlier in this conversation that we are really needing to reevaluate what we used to think and how we used to manage. And one of the things that is really coming to the foreplay is climate change and the movement of organisms to accommodate changing environments. And so there's, you know, half of the ecological world that believes that we should be moving animals now, or animals and plants now, and the other half believes that we still need to maintain some sort of integrity. So that's a really tough question, and I don't really have the answer to it.
Fair enough. Now, so how long, or can we even project how long can the current population be sustained on the island before it just ultimately collapses?
Well, so the population, the iguana population on St. Thomas is not likely to collapse because it really is being sustained by humans and human activities. You know, you could ask the same question about the human population here. We have an island that's 13 miles long by 5 miles wide, and we have about 50,000 people that live on this island, and it's really kind of past its carrying capacity for humans, let alone iguanas. And so long as tourists keep coming and the ships keep coming with more food, we can certainly sustain both the humans and the iguanas.
Yeah, and just for a figure for you all to have in mind, St. John is even smaller. It's 9 miles by 5 miles, and we receive over 1 million tourists a year, at least, that come onto the island. And so when we think, and I like these kind of questions because really the film and what we're trying to do with this, we come in with a conversation about iguanas because this is something that's in everyone's face every day. I've got, you know, 1,000 iguanas. There used to be 5. You know, and so it's tension. But the conversation we really drive with people is, why are there more iguanas? What's happening in the entire system around you? And thinking about it, and how do we, you know, not have to end up in these kind of places to begin with? And this is exactly what Renata is talking about. These systems are overwhelmed already. The iguanas are just one small piece of it. You know, we have a whole broader ecosystem there. And how do we get people thinking about that by coming in with the iguanas, something that, you know, is in somebody's face every day to get them to think more broadly about the topic?
All right.
So I would just like to throw in a comment right now that I'm sitting here in my living room. It's 10 o'clock at night, and the frogs are calling. And I'm really excited because this is the first time this year that the frogs have called. Tonight is the first night that the frogs are calling. And they because today was the first day this year that we've received a significant amount of rainfall. But the frogs are declining, and there are other native animals that I used to see even in the 10 years that I've been here that I'm not seeing anymore, and things that were very, very hard to locate to begin with are now, I haven't seen them for a number of years. So yes, the whole system, there's more than just the iguanas here, and the iguanas are really just a small part of the question, really.
Now, some of the other questions, Jimmy, if you have any other questions, I'm going to run through mine real quick here because there was one that I had that I wanted to grab and I can't find it.
Actually, it's been going so well. All the questions I have, they've been answering back and forth already. So, actually, there is a question I do have, and it's going to go to each one of you because I want you guys, or you ladies, to tell me exactly what you would do to kind of solve the problem, so humans and native people and also, you know, tourism and stuff like that, what would you personally recommend to do with these iguanas and how to manage them the way you see fit? Because I'm sure everybody has their own little way to look at it, but Crystal, let me start with you. How would you manage it?
Right, and that's so great. It's such a nice question to be asked. I ask everybody else all the time and try to pull that into the film, right? And so I'm just going to preface it by speaking back to the film, right? And then I'll tell you what I think. You know, there are so many different kinds of solutions that people offer, but how can, you know, I come at it, well, two things. One, I come at it from an academic's perspective, and then I also have, you know, my personal perspective as well. For me, right, I would like to move forward with this with as few iguanas being killed as possible. I don't like the idea of killing iguanas. Just don't. However, and I could say the same thing about lionfish, and anyone familiar with the Virgin Islands or anywhere in the Caribbean, you know, they know what's happening with lionfish. But I don't want to kill the lionfish either. So, but do some animals have to be called or disappear? Possibly, right? So, you know, for me, one of the most important conversations is to think about how can we reduce the number of iguanas that are there without relocating them, without moving them. You know, Renato will be able to speak better to whether this is a viable solution, but, you know, I've seen some work where people create artificial areas for the iguanas to lay their eggs, and when they lay the eggs, you know, they sort of, one of the models I saw has some drawers that they pull them out and then they crush the eggs. Now, I know someone might start thinking, well, are the eggs life? Okay, and then we're going to get into a really hard conversation. But, you know, what are the places where we can start to reduce the population that's there and at the same time have the population of people have a better understanding, if they don't want more iguanas, of how to keep those iguanas from increasing? And what does that mean? That means being more careful about your property, being more careful in the world, just like a pet owner. You know, how are you going to be more careful about the animals that are in your presence and being more cognitive of that? So, I would like to reduce the population that's there and then also have people be smarter about how they're engaging wildlife in their neighborhoods, in their yards.
Great. So, Renata, let me ask you. Being on the herpetologist side of things, how would you look at really reducing the population of iguanas? Would you reduce the population? Or, you know, how do you draw that line and what do you personally want to do or how would you personally see the reduction done?
Yeah, so I think there's a couple of questions that you need to really ask before you decide, you know, what's my ideal number of in my population. And one of the questions that I was addressing at when I was at the Division of Fish and Wildlife was, so where's the problem? And the problem was very much in the human environment. So the humans were having a problem with the iguanas, and as far as I was concerned, the iguana issue wasn't as great an issue in, for the local environment as some of the other things that are going on here. And so certainly in terms of a resource management question and the resources that you have available to manage these, iguanas as an ecological resource were not an issue to me. However, as a human resource, they are, because they're causing a lot of economic damage. And so I would wholeheartedly agree with Crystal that we don't want to start moving them around. We want to stop moving them around. We want to contain the populations that we have. And I think a really effective way of reducing the population is, preventing the successful breeding of these organisms. There's enough organisms that are, enough of these iguanas that are breeding in natural environments on the beach. Right now, the beaches are just absolutely covered in iguana eggs. So even if every single person destroyed every single nest on their property, we would still have successful breeding of iguanas every year.
Let me stop you right there.
Okay.
Let me stop you right there, because it leads into another question I have. So I'm not looking at it as killing every egg or disposing of every egg. But if you have native people doing it on their properties and they're disposing of them properly, wouldn't that cut the amount down? And then over time, they would fill into the areas and get off the beaches and not progress any further than what they are. And then over time, you can manage it to a smaller and smaller amount. No?
Yeah, I think the iguanas will fill in according to the resources that are available. But certainly, yeah, if the iguanas, if the reproduction can be reduced, I think that people can maintain manageable populations for sure.
Great. And then one last one, Jessica. What's your feeling on that? How would you reduce the population? Would you reduce the population? And how would you go about it?
Right. Well, I mean, and this is coming from the perspective of a former iguana owner and an animal lover, and not necessarily from a biological standpoint. For, you know, Renata is the expert here, you know, PhD, so is Crystal. But, I mean, just from my perspective, I spent hours and hours walking through the national park looking for iguanas and couldn't find any, right? And when you're in the more urban developed areas, you know, you can't walk anywhere without finding one. So, I mean, to me, a possible solution would be to move them into the national park. Just because I don't want to see them be killed. I say, look at Renata's face. That's hilarious. Right. Yeah, no, I mean, you know, if we want to redistribute so they're not all in one area, I mean, that could be one solution. I could see Renata as a big advocate of that idea, right? But, you know, I mean, just I don't want to see them necessarily be killed either. I mean, they're already there. So just from the animal lover's perspective, there's got to be a solution without, you know, harming as many animals as possible. That would just be my perspective on it.
Great. John, you got any questions there? I think the ladies answered my question pretty well, because personally, I think the whole solution for me, and just my standpoint, I would have to go with the collection of eggs. Maybe taking females, finding out where they're laying. Are they communal layers in certain areas? If they are, check that spot continuously. Dispose of the eggs would possibly be the best solution to lower the population and stop the increase of the population. But I think my biggest thing would be stop human development on the island, period, because it seems like the iguanas are 100% following where the humans are going. And if you increase human development, you're going to increase the amount of iguanas.
Yeah, it's a very complex, right? Because let's just say this as well. You could have development and have property owners who don't feed them, for example. Or maybe you have some property owners who are able to feed a certain amount and they're responsible about it. And then you might have somebody else who is creating and bringing in. There are certain kind of plants iguanas like more, right? Big flowery plants. There are ways, I think, that individual property owners can reduce their property so that it's not as much of a draw. And somebody else might not care at all. But on the other hand, we already have lots of villas there and lots of pools, right? So it's also a question of, are you telling people they can't have, right? So I get this all the time with the film, right? They love their pool in their backyard. So what, they can't have a pool because the iguanas are going to increase in population? So, you know, it's this real, debate about whose responsibility it is. You know, is it Fish and Wildlife? Is it Department of Natural Resources? Should they come in and call the population? Should it be left to individual property owners to make decisions? Do we need better laws? So it's really complicated.
Absolutely, and it's going to be complicated. I mean, there is no real simple solution, but us as humans, we need to find that balance. Whether it be stopping production on the island and stop building houses and seize it or build this amount per year till we control the population. That could possibly be a solution in my book. I know you, in the film and in the trailer, I know you go over some of the techniques that have been tried out on lowering the amount of food for the iguanas. Is that correct, Crystal, as well?
Well, Renata talks about that in the trailer a bit, and then in the film there'll be a lot more that, you know, helps people think about this. And, another solution for people is to wrap, I forget what it's called, but it's like a silver lining around trees so the iguanas can't crawl up it. There are ways to change your plants. And this conversation, by the way, if anyone's listening from Florida, this isn't just a conversation for the Virgin Islands, or anywhere that we have a lot deer. Hello, anyone in the Northeast? I mean, someone wrote here, it's similar to other animals. How do we create a better balance? Because the thing, another point to make here is that, regardless of when the iguanas came, at some point there were some more predators is a good question to think about as well. And, are those gone? What were they? A really weird, quirky piece of the conversation for St. John, at least, based on some interviews with the National Park Service personnel there, is that, we have mongoose in the Virgin Islands as well, which were, imported long ago to try to deal with the snake population. I think someone can jump in. I think, Renata, you probably know that story as well. So we have a lot of mongoose on the island. And the mongoose population was being partly controlled by the Park Service because it's a non-native invasive itself, which eats turtle eggs. And there was some disease with the rats. Renata is saying rats, not snakes. Okay, rats. and so the mongoose population decreased. And that could be a contributing factor as to why there's been an increase in iguana population on St. John, at least. But again, we don't have solid scientific studies that show us one way or the other. There are a lot of theories about why we have so many iguanas happening now, and it's like contributing factors all around. But it is a bigger question of humans and how we're interacting. Animals we bought there before, animals, we don't have as many predator species as we used to.
Right.
Wow, this is amazing.
I'm glad you mentioned other parts of the country, because being in Florida, some of my friends that are watching can vouch for this. And Crystal, we were talking in the pre-interview. I was talking about Cuban tree frogs here in Florida being an alien species. And how do we actually manage that? Well, Florida came out and says if you find them, you can identify them, you freeze them. And they give you a whole thing on how to do it correctly, on freezing the Cuban tree frogs. But being a reptile guy, how do you pick killing a Cuban tree frog but always keeping the native? So it's a human feeling on whether they're going to kill it or they're not going to kill it. Neighbors may like the Cuban tree frogs, and I know a chatter executive producer loves the sound of them when they call. Me, it's annoying as heck, but only because I've seen them eat native frogs. I've seen them eat lizards. I've seen them eat pretty much anything that they come across. So I don't care for them. So, but, yeah, I mean, throughout the whole world, there's always an invasive species somewhere that's going to thrive better in that ecosystem than what was native. Am I correct in that?
Well, so that's what I alluded to before, that invasive species or non-native species, what makes for, and animals have been moved around, and some have made it, and some haven't made it, and the ones that make it are the ones that are, you know, prolific breeders. They have a lot of offspring. Cuban tree frogs can lay 20,000 eggs in a go. They can eat anything, can get around on their own capability. They don't need to be moved around. They can survive without resources for long periods of time. And these all very, very clearly describe the Cuban tree frog and other organisms like the slider, the red-eared slider that's also been introduced to a number of different places, including here. We also have the Cuban tree frog. I've done a lot of studies on them. Cockroaches are also introduced, and they show the same characteristics. So, yeah, they are going to outcompete the native at some point, for sure.
And, you know, to jump into that as well, it's, you know, from that conversation, it's just such a great place into my social cultural perspectives on how I study invasive species. You know, what you were just pointing to, James, is a lot of times you'll end up with people just like yourself who end up killing an animal that they might, that they don't necessarily want to kill, but it's because they're also interested in protecting other animals and ecosystems from becoming so unbalanced. But what I like to think about with our film work, especially with my company, is to think about how can we have conversations with humans, you know, H-U-M-A-N-S's, so that we can try to avoid those kind of situations or at least decrease them. And I'm not talking about keeping ecosystems static or, you know, some idealized version of them, but how do we think more carefully in advance as humans, individuals, communities, about the kind of decisions we're making that are not only going to impact, you know, we think a lot about water, air, but how are the animals in the mix as well? And what does it mean if invasive or introduced species show up? What does it mean for those species? And, you know, because an iguana, we have farmers in the film who talk about this really well. You know, it's not like the iguanas out there, like, trying to intentionally piss off, or do you believe that kind of stuff, piss off all the people. You know, they're just opportunists. They're eating. They're filling up a... You know, they're doing what iguanas do. People, us, we're able to evaluate and think more carefully about the decisions we're making that impact the rest of the world, and I think we have a strong responsibility to do that.
Right. Now, as far as our strong responsibility to do that, basically the whole, not really the whole reason, but one of the major reasons we had you on the show tonight, Crystal, with Jessica and Renato as well, was you have this awesome campaign over at Kickstarter.com, and we're also going to put that in the show notes as well. But just so folks can check it out, it's It Ain't Easy Being Green, and you can just go to Kickstarter. You should be able, if I'm not mistaken, there's a search bar right there on Kickstarter. You drop drop the name in there, It Ain't Easy Being Green. You should pull up the film. That's pretty much how we can help right now. What are some of the other ways that herpetoculturists or herpetologists that are watching the show, Renata, if you want to jump in on this, as well as Jessica as well, what can we ask our community and our colleagues to do as far as helping out with future projects such as the film and moving forward with reptile conservation and things, you know, interacting with humans and that kind of thing? Where can we help you guys out the best? Just donations, or would it be to possibly get internships, or what type of assistance can we help out with?
Renata, do you want to talk a bit about the kind of needs that there are in the Virgin Islands for work around this? And then I can speak a bit to the film, and Jessica might have some things to add, too.
Oh, my gosh, where do I start? So I was the wildlife biologist at Fish and Wildlife for 9 years. I'm now no longer there. I'm at the University of the Virgin Islands trying to train the next generation. But for those 9 years, for the most part, I was pretty much by myself. And if I needed to do something, if something needed to be done, it had to be something that I could do myself without any assistance from anyone else. So people being aware, people understanding what the situation, people willing to help out, those are all really key things for sure. There's a tremendous, the door is wide open. There's a tremendous amount of projects that people could get involved with. What we don't have is money to do them.
Okay. Now, are there volunteer opportunities anywhere out there that where, you know, because I see a lot of, not a lot, but I see a couple of studies come around every so often of basically, you know, you pay your way here and we'll feed you for 2 weeks, but we're going to have you, you know, chasing small lizards all over the desert for, you know, 2 weeks and sweating profusely. And you're going to enjoy it because you like reptiles. Do you guys have opportunities like that, where basically you'll feed a couple of people to come out and, you know, chase lizards around or anything?
We do not have those projects. We do not have those opportunities because we do not have the money to support the volunteers. It's very, very expensive here, and even in getting stateside students to come for the summer, stateside school classes to come, the flights to the Virgin Islands are like twice the price of the flights to Puerto Rico. So, and there's more opportunities to do those types of activities in Puerto Rico just because it's bigger, there's more people. Here, we really don't have a lot of scope to organize those types of activities. Having said that, you know, there are Sierra Club projects that take place on St. John at Veers, and there's a number of different opportunities within the Virgin Islands that people could participate in, for sure.
Okay.
I'll add. Veers, what Renata just mentioned, is the Virgin Islands Ecological Research Station, and mm-hmm. it's situated on the south part of St. John. And they often host researchers from many universities and scholars from around the world to come and do specific work in the Virgin Islands. And it's relatively inexpensive. The Virgin Islands is a very expensive place to be. Outrageously expensive for a lot of reasons. That's another conversation. But there are you know, places like this ecological research station where you know, you sign up as a researcher and you get a reduced rate to stay. It's also an eco camp, so you know, they're off the grid, and it's really a remarkable place. It's Veers, V-I-E-R-S. If anyone's interested in looking into that. You know, there are also opportunities like between Renata and myself and some other, you know, faculty and scholars in the Virgin Islands to sign up to do master's projects or research projects. I try to bring students down from my university every summer to do different kind of work. There was a set of students from the university, Renata, you'll have to help me remember, Newcastle University in the UK that came.
Yeah, that's cool. Newcastle.
They did a great study looking at injuries to iguanas in the Virgin Islands. Renata, do you remember some of the data from that, or what some of their results were?
Yeah, they did some questionnaires and surveys, and they looked at kind of locations where the iguanas were. They did that as a expedition from their university in the UK, and the UK really supports the having students go abroad to do projects, to do their own projects. Certainly, there's been a lot of school groups coming down to university groups coming down to Veers. We do. The University of the Virgin Islands is here. We do have a master's program in marine and environmental science.
Okay. All right. Now, as far as... what was the overall attraction as far as the iguanas on the island itself and the interaction with the humans? What how did you come to, outside of the lionfish and meeting each other on the islands, what specifically attracted you, Crystal, to learning more about the interaction with the iguanas and the humans?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you know, I think Renata and Jessica can both understand this as well because they've been connected to the Virgin Islands for a long time. When I first started doing my dissertation fieldwork there in 1996, I can barely recall seeing an iguana on St. John. I mean, I saw them, mm-hmm. but they weren't everywhere. and you know, after I finished doing some work on donkeys. There's a lot of donkeys on St. John, too. They live actually a good bit in the park and less around human communities, but they're there as, around people as well. But, you know, I started seeing so many iguanas, and it's the conversation on the island. I mean, you're not going to walk somewhere. I mean, even just this past, you know, 2 or 3 weeks when we sent out our production or our director of photography, Bill Stelzler, who's on the island, to film some iguanas, I just sent out a quick request to like 15 people on St. John. Where can Bill find iguanas to film? Everyone wrote back, in my yard. Mm-hmm. You know, I've got 100 of them. I've got 50 of them. Send him over. And so, it, you know, it just becomes a part of people's lives. And, you know, so as an academic, you're often looking for, you know, what's happening, what's on the ground, what can I look at, what can I research. And then from a film perspective, this is great because you have a conflict of perspectives on animals. And, you know, when you think about film, just to shift a little bit into thinking about film here, film is about stories. And the best way to attract people in is to have something that they're going to respond to, connect to. I mean, you have to have a story to tell. And, you know, the fact that some people love them, I mean, some people love them. And when I say love them, I mean love them, right? Like, they'll swim on, they'll lay on them in their pools, right? And, you know, and they develop a relationship. And I don't diminish that at all, right? Especially because I love animals and like to think about how we have relationships with different kinds of animals. You know, reptiles especially, iguanas, lizards. For so many people, they can easily connect to the idea, and you know, I think Jessica and all of you might speak to this in your audience as well. You know, people first of all think of pandas or dogs, and you know, mammals often come to mind as a way that people are building relationships with animals. And what's fascinating for me about the iguana story as well is that amongst all the people that are part of the film, there are a number of people who speak really powerfully and movingly about their own relationship and experience with iguanas. Of course, there are others who, well, you know, they've got their BB gun on. They don't have, you know, so for me, as a scholar in animal-human studies, it's a great case to look at this range of perspectives on how somebody comes at their relationship with an iguana. I bet someone could write something in and ask a question about that. But Jess, I know you've got, you know, from your own experience with an iguana and pet, and then being, you know, in the wild on St. John, and Renata, I'm sure something too.
Right. Well, I mean, to echo what Crystal was saying, I mean, you know, I had been going with her on these research trips since 1996, and, you know, I had a pet iguana at that time, and we had even talked about, you know, when I was there, wow, there's not many iguanas here. And over the years, it just exploded, right? And now you can't go anywhere without seeing the iguanas. So, you know, from my perspective, you know, I already had a stake in the game. I was always already interested in the iguana. And then just to see the attitudes on the island and the explosion. And frankly, I got to say, there's a lot of dead iguanas on the road. You know, people run them over. I saw, you know, a group of little boys harassing them, you know, along the beach, you know, the tour. I mean, you know, so it's just, you know, very interesting to be with a cultural anthropologist like Crystal and be studying the different reactions. You know, my favorite scene from our film is in a bar, and there's a bartender who has a maraschino cherry. You know, really, I swear, and it's in the trailer. Go to our website, please. Look at our Kickstarter campaign. So there's bartender has a straw with a maraschino cherry on the top, and he's...
I know.
Yeah, he puts it in the air, and the iguana just takes it off the top. I mean, it's hilarious, but it's true. You know, this is what goes on, you know. So it's just very interesting to see, you know, how the attitudes changed over the years and the population. So, I was definitely in and really enjoyed it and enjoyed, you know, hearing everybody's perspectives on the iguana.
That's one of the things that I'm really interested in. You know, I don't want to make the show go over time, but I would definitely like to get you ladies together again just so I could have conversations with you about the conservation and the attitudes towards reptiles and the whole cultural aspects behind everything else with the reptiles anyway. Gosh, that's just... And the other scene, too, that was followed that one was the lady in the garden talking about, you know, how she just planted all these wonderful garden vegetables. And within, like, 24 hours, they're all gone. And I was like, wow, it's like you're damned if you do, damned if you don't. It's like, what are you supposed to do?
Yeah, and Renata mentioned earlier about the hotel when they planted everything and it was gone quite quickly. Right. The farmer that you see in the film, that's the St. John doesn't have that many farms. In fact, that's probably the only large one. St. Thomas and St. Croix have more farming going on than St. John. But on St. John, that farm produces so much of the greens that are available to hotels and to local residents. And she's not able to produce any longer certain types of vegetables from her farm because she's had to switch away from certain crops because of the iguana being there. You know, but yet, to speak more of that, they really understand. You know, being a farmer, you're constantly aware of what's going on around you, what's impacting your crops, the animals, the system, and you know, they speak really powerfully in the film about. It's the iguana, but it's not just the iguana. And we said that earlier. You know, it's how does it interact with all the other species? What's happening on the island that impacts these changes in certain species? But yeah, I mean, you know, there's an important question. There are ethical questions all around in the film. Everything from what are the ethics of killing a invasive species, whether it's native or not native? And then, of course, ethical questions about, well, what happens if an animal is destroying someone's entire livelihood. You know, how do you try to figure this out? And again, that's what I'm interested in as a filmmaker and as a scholar, is how do we coexist, interact with animals on the planet? And this is, I can't say it enough, this is a question that we're going to continually face moving forward. You know, pick any place you want and ask someone, you know, you have an invasive species there, or, you know, some people call them invasive species, I understand why, but I also like to say, you know, these are animals, they're not intentionally there trying to harm us, but the situation has created an ecosystem and world we live in that's a mess, and that's not the animal's responsibility, that's ours. So I know I'll get off my, like a soapbox, but that's the truth.
No, I understand.
From where I stand.
All right, Jim.
All righty. Well, I tell you what, from looking at the trailers and everything I've read on Kickstarter and everything like that, it looks like a great production. My question is, and Crystal, I asked you in our pre-interview, my question is, what do you see coming out of this film? Where do you see it after it's produced, DVD sales, everything's done? Where do you want this film to go? I mean, is it any certain, do you want it to be picked up by a conservation place and use it to help raise funds? Do you want it to stay as a private film, independent film? Where do you see it kind of fit in? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a great question. Thanks for asking. You know, with film production, there are a couple of different routes. Sometimes people have a plan laid out well in advance for distribution, and they make contracts or commissions with, say, like a large entity like PBS or BBC, and you know, you're able to produce a film in a certain kind of way because you know the audience. And you know, that's often a bigger scale production, and you have all the right connections and partnerships. You know, for me, this is my first film. I'm moving from an academic into the film world. My partner in the company has been making films for 20 years. And so he has all of, you know, that world that we're able to work with. But that said, we're still a small production company. And, you know, in other words, we don't initially just able to jump right in with BBC. You know, there's a whole world of film. But there are lots and lots of other opportunities for how to distribute films. And so we started making the film with a couple of audiences in mind. I mean, I'd love to get on PBS if anyone's listening. And we try to work that as well. But we don't have something set up in advance. So what you do when you produce a film in this way is that, you know, we finish up with the production, we start to make rough cuts, and then we start to market it to people. And so the best way to do that, if there are any aspiring filmmakers out there, is that you need to start attending film festivals. You know, in the animal world, you know, some of the wildlife and around animals, you know, some of the largest are the Jackson Hole Wildlife Film Festival, which happens in Wyoming every 2 years. And then this fall is Wild Scream, which happens in the UK. And this is where everyone from the industry comes together, filmmakers, producers, and distributors, right? So this is that question of how are you distributing it? You have to be thinking really clearly and carefully about who you're going to work with. And so being an academic, I also have a lot of connections into the academic world. And so there's an organization called Green Planet Films, which is a clearinghouse for a lot of films around conservation, sustainability, environment, that universities and libraries across the world and country can tap into and order films. There's another organization called Bullfrog Films. You know, if you're looking for environmental or sustainability or wildlife films, these are great places to check out. And so they'll distribute it for you, and you know, you'll get maybe something back. But on a production of this scale, we won't be making a whole lot of money, just enough to cover the cost. It's a lot to make films if you're not tapped into it. Bare minimum is like set. You know, it's like $1,000 a minute, bare minimum, and that's like cheap. So, you know, our film, just to give you a sense, you know, grand total towards the end for a 30-minute piece, actual cash out will be about $25,000, and then all of the time donated, and, you know, not being paid, essentially, right? So, like, I get paid through my university. I have a lot of graduate students who work with me. When you're talking big productions, you know, you're looking at $200,000, $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 sometimes for major pieces. And so anyway, you know, we're looking to reach an audience on St. John and be able to distribute this, have it shown. We're going to have a big debut of it on St. John in the U.S. Virgin Islands in the fall. Renato, you'll be invited, of course, and hopefully Jesse. And then, well, the rest of you are going to come now, too. So.
Well, when you have it, can we do a pre-release interview? Have you guys back on live from St. John?
Yeah, that sounds great.
But, all right, so that sounds great. It actually sounds really good on how you have it actually wanting to go, the film festivals, release it. Now, if you make any money extra or the proceeds that you get back from the DVD, and for my audience, please support it. Go to Kickstarter. Make sure they raise the $10,000 mark by Saturday.
Yeah.
So this film can get done, because I want to see it. But, you know, say you actually have some monies coming back from the film to replenish what was done. Are you going to take those monies and do another film? And if so, do you have any idea of where you might handle that?
Thanks for asking, and that's exactly right. With such a small production company, especially with the first piece done, absolutely that money gets rolled. Anything that comes in is going to roll right over to making a next film. And on our chat here, I see Renata asking to make films about the Virgin Islands boa. And so there are a lot of possibilities. But, you know, one of the great interests that my partner in the film company and I have is to think about this relationship between pets and ecosystems. And so if I had my dream next film, it's to look at, I like to celebrate the love that people have for animals, and I don't really care what kind it is, invasive, not, whatever. I like the idea of thinking about how humans connect with other species, but how do we do that responsibly in relationship to the rest of the world, animals, ecosystems? And so the case that I'm most interested in right now is to think about fish and the oceans, and you know, the lionfish story is particularly interesting. You know, it's not proven, but maybe it's the case that somebody released some. You know, how do we think about, you know, you don't want to kill an animal, so you might go and release it. But are there other better ways? So, for example, a model that I like a lot right now is what Florida's doing, in fact. Maybe you've seen the stories with this, is that they have a exotic species amnesty day where, you know, if you're not able to take care of an animal, you can bring it somewhere and someone will, rather than it ending up in a system where it doesn't belong and can cause additional harm. And so how do we celebrate love for animals but also be responsible in that space?
Right. Well, good. Well, I look forward to seeing this film. And once again, I'm going to promote it one more time. Go to Kickstarter. It ain't easy being green. You can catch it on my Facebook page. You can catch the trailer on my Facebook page, or go to Reptile Living Room fan page. You can also go to reptileliveroom.com after this is done, and we'll have all the links there. We have them in the description here on YouTube. Go to Kickstarter. They have great – Reptile Living Room actually donated $50 to the production. And, you know, it's – the end all was I wanted to see the DVD. So when you go buy any movie, it's going to cost you $30 anyway. So at least I know it's going to a good cause. And it's something that, you know, really tickled my fancy to see somebody actually working with it. And you ladies have actually made John and I, and I think John can agree with me here, open our eyes to a place that we would have never thought that needed the amount of work to study the animals on these islands, whether it be St. John, St. Thomas, St. Croix. It's unbelievable to me that people don't want to donate their time or money to go help with this research. So if there's any way that John and I, Reptile Living Room, Tremendous Tricolors, Cold-Blooded Publishing, Herp House, if there's anything, any three of you ladies have that you want to try to work on a big project, let us know.
Yeah, sure.
Hopefully we'll be able, if we can't find you tons of dollars, maybe we can find you people that will be willing to say, hey, I'll go pay for a week and spend it there, and I'll spend it on the island, you know, helping these ladies out. So be sure to let us know, and we can help you out that way as well. John, you got any ending questions?
Actually, I need to mention, or actually have Jessica mention, rather, there's a reward to name an iguana. Did I miss something?
Right. Yeah. No. If you look on our Kickstarter campaign, you know, one of the things about Kickstarter is we want to engage all of our backers in a personal way. So we offer several rewards if you do contribute, and one of them is if you donate $100, you can name an iguana in the movie, as long as it's not obscene or in other ways, you know, offensive, you know. But otherwise, we're pretty open. And we have a lot of other fun rewards. There's still a reward actually right now. If you go right now, you can make a donation and you can earn a day on the set of our film. You can help us film and you can have an appearance in the film itself if you are willing to make a very large donation. So there's all kinds of different rewards. So please check out our Kickstarter page and see all the fun ways you can be involved with our project.
And for anybody interested, Renata needs help capturing frogs for chytrid swabbing. And we all know how much fun chytrid swabbing is. But you're in the Virgin Islands. Did I mention that part?
All I need is two palm trees and a hammock. Oh, and I forget ice.
I'm kicking ice for the summer. Anyway, ladies, thank you so much for me personally being on. I definitely look forward to speaking with all of you in the future in regards to numerous projects that I personally have going on reptile behavior and reptile-human interaction and cultural aspects and various other sundry books and things that I want to write. An amazing show. Just very informative. Like James, like our host James said there, never thought in a million years that we would be talking about the Virgin Islands and, you know, invasive species. I mean, that just never crossed my mind. It's just a tourist attraction. There's really nothing there, but, you know, tourists, evidently not. Wow.
Well, you know, the craziest thing was the pre-show conversation I had with Renata and an alien species of corn snake on the island. So that was an incredible conversation, and we really didn't get into it. Of course, we don't have enough time to really get over everything. But
they're coming back on anyway, hopefully.
Great.
Right. All right, ladies. Well, I thank you very much for coming on. If there's anything we can help you out with in the time being, hopefully we'll be able to do so. Our audience, I'm going to ask you one more time. Go out there, donate the $10, $25, $50, $100, $250. And I think there's one $750 one left too, right? Still one?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I expect everybody to fulfill all those so they can go ahead and get this film done. And actually, any monies over the $10,000 will help get them to the film festivals too. Thank you very much for watching, everybody. We'll catch you next week, Thursday night, 9 o'clock. You can subscribe to our YouTube channel, youtube.com/reptilelivingroom. Make sure you visit reptilelivingroom.com for any little insights and behind-the-scenes stuff from the show. And you can actually catch us on iTunes, too, as well. John, you got anything else for last two words?
And we are also out on Stitcher Radio broadcast channel now as well. We have been out there for a while. Evidently, it's supposed to be going into, like, all the newer car models are supposed to get this Stitcher Radio system in it now, so I don't know. That's about all I got. Look forward to going to the Virgin Islands at some point in the next 3 to 6 months and spending the rest of my life there chasing lizards, frogs, whatever. I'll be broadcasting from the palm trees, Jimmy.
Yeah, you'll be the new iguana counter.
Exactly. I'm putting Jessica out of a job.
Iguana counter.
I don't know about that. I'm the head iguana counter.
John, you'll be working underneath her. Iguana counter and pressure washer.
Exactly. Iguana counter and pressure washer.
All right, ladies. Thanks a lot for coming on.
Thanks a lot, folks.
And we wish you the best.
Bye.
Bye.